What if you could get career advice from a mentor without having to schedule a meeting with them? Find out how by building yourself with AI next. So, welcome to the Cozy AI Kitchen. Today we have a very special guest, my dear friend Kevin Buthane, who is a polymath, meaning he is a designer, business, engineer. He's like all of them together, and he is an award-winning author. Kevin, how are you doing, Kevin?
I'm doing great, John. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, you see what I'm carrying here? I'm carrying some AI models.
They look heavy.
So Kevin, what we're going to do today is we're going to be cooking with these two models. You see, you're a special guest, so you get to have two models. And one is the regular kind of completion model, but the other one is, you know, it's that embedding model. Hmm. Now, everyone knows the completion model, right? You know about the completion model out there, but the embedding model, so exciting. Because with an embedding model, what you get are these wonderful vectors of numbers, long vectors of numbers. This is long grain embeddings, vectors just like your grandma used to make. So we're gonna use grandma's vector embeddings to do something pretty amazing. Now, Kevin, can you talk a little bit about reimagining design while I put my apron on, because sometimes I get it wrong?
Sure. No. So reimagining design. Last March of 2022, I had the privilege of having my first book published, thanks to the MIT Press. And with reimagining design, I tell a story about how design changed my life and also how I watched design transform organizations for the better. And the perspectives that I share come from a series of unique multidisciplinary leaps across engineering, business, and design. And my hope is that the book is serving as a mirror for folks to see themselves differently and perhaps how they might influence their own organizations differently moving forward.
So Kevin is a coder. And Kevin actually debugged some of my code in a book that I wrote, and he noticed my code was wrong, so look out. But Kevin, what we're going to do is we're going to use regular code for this cooking session, regular code, good old-fashioned code, but we're also going to bring out, because it's you, Kevin, the good stuff. This is semantic code, right?
Okay.
It's magical. It's got this amazing property. It's like next level. And we're going to be able to bring in a mentoring plugin, because I know a lot of people look up to you as someone who they want to become. I've seen this stuff on social. So we're going to like cook this up. Basically, we need a plugin, the mentoring plugin. I don't want too much of that. And we need a lot of semantic code, because there's a lot of prompts involved in that. So I get that in there. This part can go wrong sometimes, Kevin, so be careful. Okay, there we go. Okay, and then we're going to add, of course, some old-fashioned code. You know, it's good. But, Kevin, I did something that I hope you're okay with, which is I used the internet to gather some of your famous quotes. Yeah, I know, they're on there. So I'm going to, like, add those to the orchestration process. And, of course, grandma's embeddings, right? Because we want to like make sure that it gets like encoded correctly. And let's now cook that up on the computer, shall we? Okay, so you can see it over there. All right, so this is the Cozy AI Kitchen. Everyone who loves to look at code, reminder, this is Kevin Buthane, none other than Kevin Buthane. This is one of my favorite quotes by Kevin. We should leverage uncertainty for the powerful creativity-inducing variable it is. Kevin, this stuff is non-deterministic. So that's the definition of uncertain. What's your take?
No, I think we definitely, when we think about the creative process, there's a lot of non-linearity to it. And I think we can leverage that in terms of how we connect the past with our present moment, how we sort of anticipate and view the future, ideally through a multitude of different lenses, vantage points, diversity of perspective. So, and that was a motorcycle in the background. I'm sort of in the city here in LA.
That's real stuff. This is real stuff. This is live. Well, here I am. I'm basically getting the digital version. This is a digital twin. By the way, Kevin had a long career in consulting. He's like a vice president of BCG. He's like that level. So to him, he's like, yeah, I get you, John. So here we go, Kevin. I'm going to take some quotes.
Okay.
I believe it's very important to be more upfront. The team needs, there's all this good stuff about leadership. So I'm going to send that into the embedding converter. So now that's taking all those strings and then making long vectors of numbers. And what we can do next is we can ask questions of that information. For instance, here I have two questions, not really questions, but find the thing that's closest to facing hard realities. Find the thing that is how to work together. So here we go. So let's cook it out. There we go. So see, it's facing hard realities. Apparently, Kevin, you said something like, I believe it's very important to be more upfront about the hard realities. Ha-ha. How to work together. The team. So notice how it matched those two things in your quotes, right? So, but like, let's say I instead said like, how to make a pizza or something like this. And like, versus challenges of businesses. So now what happens is, if you notice, when you search for how to make a pizza, it brings up the team needs to learn how to work together. Isn't that sort of weird how it did that?
Indeed.
It's a kind of example of how, you know, sometimes it finds things that are similar, and you could kind of like squint your brain a little bit and think, yeah, the team does have to make the pizza kind of thing. challenges of business, you know, upfront hard realities, and so this kind of model finds things that are similar. And mind you, there's a similarity index from 0 to 1. So it can be like 0.1 similar. So the hit might be 0.1, not that great, or 0.9. But what you can do with that is you can then go and basically like use the gravity inducing power of the similarity. Find what might be similar. Like, I like this quote by Kevin here. This one, less relevant, probably a 0.1. This one, probably a 0.9. I'm going to now take that piece of you, Kevin, out. Does it hurt? Is it all right? Are you okay?
I'm okay.
You're okay. Okay. I'm going to, but now what I'm going to do is I have two regular AI plugins here. One does career advice. See how it's called career advice generic? And all it does is it basically says, respond succinctly as a mentor in the field of design. Okay, so that's like, and that is Kevin, but it's not Kevin. So I'm going to ask it for advice. What should I become? It's going to do what's called hallucination, basically. As a mentor in the field of design, I, Kevin, would advise you to consider becoming a graphic designer. I don't know if Kevin would say that. Industrial designer, he might say that. Oh, well, he would say that. Or his experience, he would say that too. All right, so 2 out of 3, kind of hallucinated. Now, what happens is if I give it to a career advice grounded plugin, and what that is I basically said, I'm going to give you some beliefs. Don't add any extra detail. Don't deviate. Okay. So we're going to go back, and we're going to give this version of the AI processing to include that one belief to the question, what should I become? And as a mentor in the field of design, I, Kevin, believe it's important to be more upfront about the hard realities. So that's Kevin, the mentor, right? I mean, this Kevin, I think, you know, you or I wouldn't mind saying that, but it's not what you or I might say, but here is something on point. And of course, you can add fuzziness to that response. So it isn't the same. And Kevin, as an author of a book, how does this feel if you had access to this for your new second book, upcoming one?
No, you know, definitely. I think it's almost like another means to creatively put two and two together. And maybe there could be some unexpected surprises that might intrigue me to want to, you know, go down that wormhole, if you will, and explore more.
And on that wormhole front, Kevin, you notice the temperature setting here. Because you can change the temperature of the output. It can be freezy, or it can be in a hot climate, more kind of like liberal, more kind of like whatever. So, an example of like, you can change the mood of that Kevin. What's he feeling about that, Kevin?
I say let's go for the emotional heat.
All right, that was the cooking. Thank you, Kevin, for tasting that. All right, so Kevin, you know, someone who can engineer and write and design, where do you see this kind of stuff going? I mean, would you use this in the process of your third book, which I'm sure you're thinking of, or your next project in design, or how are we going to use this, you think?
You know, I'm definitely spending a lot of time thinking about just the creative process in general, because I mean, I feel it in my own work. At the same time, I'm also hitched to client partner realities where I'm helping other organizations, my client partners, for example, navigate that creative process. And what I'm finding is that, you know, the business world tends to interpret creative approaches. You know, they definitely, I think they nod their head and say, yes, let's be human-centered, let's use design thinking and all these things. But they tend to de-risk the process. They tend to beat out any notion of risk and uncertainty. But I think as we leverage creativity, we need to embrace uncertainty for what it is. We need to embrace diverse ways of looking at the problem. And I'm a big fan of the non-linearities and nuances in the creative approach. So it would be great to have an assistant, like leveraging AI potentially, to go along different vectors that maybe I hadn't thought of before, or to see how far hard I could push using this assistant to my advantage.
Wow. So that's an example of Kevin being able to create virtual interns to work with him on his next book and or project. Look out for that coding power that you will see, because he will be using the power of semantic code in addition to his native code programming. So thank you, an incredible engineer, designer, business leader. Kevin, any last words for the visitors to the kitchen?
Oh, just, you know, I definitely think about how we shouldn't necessarily be scared about what AI is bringing to the table. I mean, I love your anecdote from South by Southwest, John, around this ketchup bottle moment. I think there's just a lot of conversation, a lot of rhetoric around the power as well as the threats that AI poses. I'm drawn to some of the works of like Timnit Gebru and Monica Belskite around, like, you know, we have to be conscious of the humanity aspect of this. Like any technology, ideally we can use this tech as a helpful enabler. And I love the examples of this cooking process that we went through, because I can start to make connections to how this could help my process. At the same time, I do think there's a tremendous opportunity for designers, creatives, to wrestle with those human imperatives and start to wrestle with that and embed that in this process, in this approach, and steer the large language models, eradicate the bias that potentially could, you know, bubble up through some of these approaches, and be solution oriented in terms of like showing examples, illustrative examples of how this new technology can help improve the human experience, improve the planet, all types of systemic issues that we want to unravel and make better. I think there's tremendous democratization of putting the power in good people's hands. Yeah.
Kevin, thank you for joining us, and thank you for reminding us that design against AI is one thing. We have to keep the critical mind.
Yes.
But also it's design against AI. Like, how do we design better than AI? So you embody both, Kevin. Thanks for joining us.
My pleasure.
Kevin came. All right, so that's that. You got to meet Kevin, one of my dear friends here in the kitchen. You're gonna meet more special people like Kevin. Hopefully you'll come back and learn more about how to cook with AI, because when you cook with AI, you can actually understand it much better. You can get beyond the mystery. And in the next episode, we're gonna go even deeper into the creative process, because creativity and AI, this is the moment, everyone. Thanks for joining us.